It's the second part of our series, What's the Issue? And we are so glad that you are joining us online. The last few months really have been a trying time. And as we head into the next few weeks of even more uncertainty, be assured that we are praying for all of our church family. We really appreciate the prayers for our ministry and the support from all of you. Let us be renewed in our spirits and keep the faith that when times seem full of despair, the Lord is truly working in us and through us. So last week we launched our Revelation series, an online Bible study on a Sunday evening with Dr. Bruce. And the series could not be more relevant considering the current world events and what an opportunity it is to be able to open up the Word, get into a deeper study and an understanding of the book of Revelation. Each part of the series comes with a set of notes that are downloadable to make it easy to follow and great for referencing. So please don't forget to download those if you are watching the series. And then speaking of getting into the Word, with our current series, which emphasizes wisdom in handling all of the difficult situations that we are facing, what better way than to get into the book of wisdom, which is Proverbs? So we are encouraging all of you, all of our church family, anybody that's interested, to start the Proverbs reading plan with us. We want to start this on the 1st of June. This plan runs in the UVersion Bible app, and we will be sending out links and invites to anybody that is interested in joining. As a church family, we can read the book of Proverbs together. It will create a connection, and obviously, we'll be learning more and more about how to handle situations with wisdom. If you would like more information via WhatsApp regarding this, or if you'd like to receive any updates via WhatsApp, of notes maybe for our Revelation series or notifications of upcoming events, please contact the church office number or send an email to info@stmarks.org.za. Leave your name and your cell phone number and we will make sure that we keep you updated via WhatsApp. We would love to keep connected with you over the next few weeks. Be challenged by the message this morning and know that in Christ, all things have been made new. You have been made new and your value is in Him alone.
We're all born into the world with a few things set. And we briefly looked at some of those set things in the first part of the series. Things like race and gender and wealth. And once we're in that framework, well, then we start to develop a sub-framework. With all the influences around us and our personal experiences that we gather over life, we start to develop our own set of beliefs. So we certainly do have a choice in how we approach our race and gender and our possessions. But when it gets to our beliefs, there's just a whole lot more choice. And it's a challenge because once you've set your beliefs, well, then you realize that yours are not the same as everybody else around you. Within the same race, the same gender, the same economic group, there are such big differences. And it could be a personality thing, like I want order and you want freedom, or I prefer arts and crafts and you like playing outside. And very soon we realize that we're different. And then we ask the question, but who's right? And on the surface, it becomes an issue. So that very simplistic explanation gets a little bit complicated when we look at more serious matters, like who's going to win the Currie Cup or the Premier League, or the elections, or is the earth flat, or is the world going to end in 2012? Well, we survived that one. Is COVID a hoax? Should you take the vaccine or not? Now it's not that simple. And people get really passionate about things, like really passionate. So we're talking riots, vandalism, police, jail, even death. Over sports teams. Those are some of the sports fans, and you've met them. Maybe you are them. Not as bad as riots and death and jail, but your family members might think it's pretty close. So the good news is we're not going to be discussing your favorite sports team today, but we are going to use it as a starting point. So just to clarify, in case there were any doubts, you do know that if your sports team is not my sports team, then you're obviously wrong. So I love using sport, not just because it riles people up. I love using it to illustrate spiritual truths because it makes things so clear and practical and seems so much quicker to get to the point. So you, as a sports team, you train and then you execute the plan and you play as a team and then you win. Or you don't train, you don't listen to the coach, and you're all selfish on the field, and then you lose. So for today, we're not going to focus as much on the sports analogy on the field. We're going to be looking more at the people in the stadium, at the fans. So you know those fans that fuel their passion with detail and build up these solid arguments as to why their team is the best. Or because we've won 15 titles and 34 trophies and we've had an unbeaten streak for 4 years and they've got all the stats that make their team look good. Because those are the only stats, aren't they? Or at least the only ones that count, surely, according to you. And we can apply this sports analogy to other areas of life where we become obsessed with the details that support our viewpoint or our opinion. And if we're not careful, we can quickly develop blind spots. And that's where that saying comes from. Blinded by passion. Fueled by our confirmation bias. Where I only search for, I only read, I only remember and repeat things that confirm my beliefs or that builds up my sports team. The people that I surround myself with, the conversations that I have, the articles I read, the news that I listen to, and if I'm not aware of it, I can quickly create my own fenced-in set of beliefs, my own worldview bubble that I identify with and believe that that's the only one that's right. And that's an easy trap to fall into. You know what it's like when you hear international news about something that's happening in your city, where there are riots and strikes and outbreaks, and it seems like it's doomsday, and you're at home sitting there thinking, well, it's not that bad. Life actually seems quite normal right now. And you could form an opinion based on sensational news, but that would be foolish. And the problem is that sensationalism is everywhere. And for the most part, it's left unchecked. So when you want to support or push a certain agenda or viewpoint, you're quickly going to find the ammo, the info that you need somewhere. And here's the difficulty. It's not just that you'll end up spreading that sensational news. You could end up believing it. And having a set of beliefs is very natural. In fact, I think it's impossible not to have a set of beliefs. But challenging your established beliefs is not as natural. And most people will avoid it completely. Because what happens if I find that what I believe is not true? And then I don't really know who I am. Because that will happen if you have non-core beliefs at the core of your identity. And then it's going to be very difficult to address those unbiasedly. So over the past few years, we've seen some pretty extreme situations explode all over the world. We've had the US elections a few years back, and now we've got the anti-vaxxers, we've had the flat earthers. How do we end up buying into some of these what seem to be radical beliefs at first? It's a very simple process. And I'm going to use myself as an example. So I'm interested in things that I like. What an obvious statement. I'm interested in things that I like. So I search for, I watch, and I listen, and I buy things that I'm interested in. So I like gadgets. Now I want to buy a Raspberry Pi. They've just brought out the Raspberry Pi 4. I want to buy Wi-Fi controlled LED bulbs. And I watch YouTube videos on mechanics and technology and the new way to solve quadratic equations. And I don't particularly like dogs, or cooking, or dieting, or conspiracies, or console games, or horror movies, or in fact, most movies. And there it is. So if you want my attention, you know what to talk about. You know what to send, what information. You know what to offer me if you were selling. And you know what not to. And that's where the algorithm enters. So the biggest companies in the world know this. Google owns YouTube. Facebook owns Instagram and WhatsApp. And all of that information that builds a profile about what you like and what you don't like. And they want your time. They want your attention. They want to interest you. And they know how to feed your interests. They form their company policies around it. And they will keep pushing it. Now, none of that I've just explained to you is new. All they're doing is they're exploiting one of our many psychological human weaknesses. Now, I mentioned something in that list of things that was a little bit out of place. I don't know if you might have known. A quadratic equation. How did that get in there? I didn't even know what a quadratic equation was before watching the video. Because that's what the algorithm does. It pushes you further and further to interest you in more extreme things. Because it's the only way to keep your attention. And if left unchecked, where do you end up? On the other side. On the extreme side. With all the details, the stats, the reasons, the info, and the passion. And I start talking to people about quadratic equations, and they start looking at me funny. And that's true for politics, for radical groups, for causes, conspiracy theories, you name it. And that's where the danger lies. When your set of preferences or your opinion becomes your primary identity at the expense of your God-given identity. And that's when you end up being passionate about the wrong things. And very quickly, what shouldn't really be an issue turns into an argument or a disagreement or a fight or a feud. And then we have to ask the question, what's the issue really? So to avoid that, what I've done, I've taken a few simple steps, and there's probably a whole lot more that I could do. I purposefully don't spend much time on social media, and I forcefully engage in conversations and seek out people who are different to me. I search for random things to mess with the algorithm and to expand my horizons. And I intentionally spend time building my identity in who God says I am. And here's one thing on this journey that has fascinated me. God so loved the world that he sent his son, his only begotten son, to be born into the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire. That's when God thought that it was best for Christ to be born. Not when David was king, not when the nation of Israel was at their prime under Solomon. No, no. The Lord came born under Roman rule, and he didn't try and change the politics. He didn't rally or campaign or protest against all the evils of the Roman Empire. In fact, he told his followers to obey the authorities. And even though it was so different to what he wanted, why? Because in all of that, well, that's where God works. God is still able to work in our differences. He does promise that the time will come when he is going to establish his perfect rule, his perfect kingdom, with the King, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the throne. Literally, that is going to be heaven on earth. But until then, well, until then, God has allowed us to have our differences. And by saying allowed, it sounds like it's a negative, like he's conceded, or he's just tolerating what's not right for now. And in a sense, it is what God is doing, but it's not necessarily how we see it. It's because it's not my preference. I just want the black and white. I just want the right or the wrong. And often that's my opinion or what I support. I want it my way. And I want you to see that my way is obviously the right way, that my team is obviously the best. So when I was in primary school, the only English Premier League side that we ever spoke about was Manchester United. They were in their prime. It was the only team I ever knew. And then as I got into high school and later finished, I met Bruce. And, well, let's just say Bruce is not a Manchester United fan. He supports the other red team. And at that stage, I didn't even know who Liverpool was. And I promise you, I don't think I've ever told Bruce this, so this is going to be a moment. For a long, long time, I thought to myself, why would you support a losing team? Have I had to eat my words over the last couple of years? Something happened. There was a shift that took place where Manchester United, who were so dominant for so long, well, they lost their glory. And then, well, then the other red team took over. I mean, I even know some congregants who support Tottenham and Leicester City. I mean, so how far do we push these? Our differences, our preferences. How much do we base our identity on those differences? How important are my opinions? And do I find my value in those differences? Or can we be different and still have the same core beliefs? And isn't that really what Paul was trying to say in Galatians 3:28? Isn't that what he was doing at Corinth? That port city where people were coming from all over the world, from so many different races and cultures and opinions and preferences. And yet that's where he says that in Christ we have a new identity. He says that to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 16 to 17. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. And what's Paul really saying there? He's saying we're not dealing on a human level, on a fleshly level, on a surface level, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh. And that statement is massive. Even though the Lord Jesus Christ was in the flesh and he was walking here on this planet, yet now we know him thus no longer. Because there's a new level, there's a new identity. And that's where he says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is now a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. There is a new core identity and a new core belief. So Paul didn't try to change the way that the Corinthians were fishing or making tents or try to get them to speak Hebrew. He wasn't trying to make them Jewish or St. Markian. He was trying to make them Christian, for them to see that they were now in Christ. And that begs the question, so where does God do his work? Everywhere, drawing all men to himself through the Lord Jesus Christ. So your Christian identity is not political or cultural or an opinion. It's the very core of who you are. Like being human, but even deeper, because there is no male and no female, no slave, no free, no Jew, no Gentile. In Christ, we are a new creation made in the image of God. And that's how God sees us. It's from that place that we now have to walk this path together and then discover, how do we fulfill our God-given role within this context of our differences? So like Daniel, when he was in captivity in Babylon, or Paul when he was in Athens, a completely different cultural setting. They weren't there just ignoring the differences. They were allowing those differences to play out, but they weren't allowing those differences to become difficulties. It's also not a push to try and find the common ground with everyone and then to set the differences aside. You know, that mindset of, let's not focus on where we disagree. Let's rather just look at what we have in common. No, this is a challenge to look beyond what we see as an issue on the surface and rather to see how God wants to use those differences, because he has allowed us to be different. It's also not an attempt to change the core beliefs of what God has said is true, that there is only one true living God who is the creator of all, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and that he sent his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to be the mediator between God and man, and that God loves us in Christ. He forgives us in Christ. He saves us in Christ. And that you are saved simply by believing that the Lord Jesus Christ died for you. That's not an opinion. It's not a culture. It's not part of a political group. That's the gospel. And that gospel is true for every single person in every single nation of the world. That in Christ, you are a new creation. As I read through the Old Testament, It's obvious how quickly the focus shifts. So it starts in the book of Genesis, and it's speaking about all the nations, Adam and Eve and all the nations that come from them. And then by chapter 12 of the very first book of the Bible, it moves to Abraham. And from Abraham, the shift all of a sudden is now on the nation of Israel that's going to come, on the Jews. But every now and then, we get this interjection of how God was using the nations around Israel, how he was working in the hearts of these foreign kings, these Gentile kings, to do his will, like King Nebuchadnezzar, King Darius, or even the wise men from the east. It wasn't God condoning their false worship or saying that idolatry was okay. It was God using all of those different circumstances and surroundings and the politics and the culture to draw people to him, because that's what God is able to do. And some of the most beautiful declarations of the true and living God, the creator of all things, comes not from the Jewish kings or scribes or prophets, but it comes from some of these Gentile kings. And I want to read this one from Darius after he throws Daniel into the lion's den and Daniel comes out unscathed. He makes this declaration in Daniel chapter 6. He says, "I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men must tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, and steadfast forever. His kingdom is the one which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall endure to the end. He delivers and rescues, and he works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth, and it is him who has delivered Daniel from the power of the lions." What an incredible statement from a nation that wasn't Jewish. And God knows that our differences are there to unlock some of the most beautiful learning opportunities if we will allow them. Because it's not a competition to prove who's right. The differences are there to challenge us and to teach us and to discover God's purpose in all things. Because when I am secure in who I am in Christ, then that security in my identity allows me to grow by challenging my other non-core beliefs. But when my political view defines me, when that is at the core, well, then I have to defend it blindly. Or when my theory on whatever fringe hypothesis defines me, well, then I have to defend that beyond reason. And the people around me, well, then they become my adversaries, my challengers, my enemies. But when your identity is based on something much bigger, much greater, much deeper, something beyond human understanding, not limited by time, something that is all-powerful and eternal and infinite, well, then that's better than a sports team, isn't it? That's better than a political party or a theory. And when that identity comes with a personal relationship and unconditional love and complete forgiveness and absolute security, well, then it allows me to explore all the differences around me without fear and to appreciate how God is able to work in and through all of this. It allows me to learn and to grow continually and to be challenged. It allows us to be different in the areas that don't really matter and still love, appreciate, and support the different people around us. So for fun, every now and then, I'll go and have a look at Justine's YouTube suggested videos. And it is so different. I scroll and scroll and scroll and scroll and nothing grabs my attention. And it's not that the suggestions are bad, they just don't interest me. But we're married, yet so different. So how are we married but so different? Well, that's because we've connected on a much greater level. Those surface differences don't affect our relationship because the core of our relationship is not based on our entertainment preferences. And one of the greatest opportunities and privileges that we have is to be able to walk this road of life closely with others who are different on those surface levels, but who share the same core values. Those core values that live deeper than our humanity, because we have been created in the image of God, and that's what He's calling us to. And God has made it possible for us to do that, to walk this road without fear of judgment or ridicule, when we know who we are in Christ. Father, thank you for this liberty, the freedom that we have in Christ. Not just the freedom from our own sins, the freedom from our past, and the freedom from ourselves, but Father, even the freedom from our prejudices, the freedom from our preferences, the freedom to be able to see others the way that you see them. And Father, I pray that we would spend more time understanding our identity in Christ and less time looking at the differences of those around us. Father, that our lives would bring you glory and honor, that we would be able to love the people around us, to push through the surface issues and to keep asking that question, Lord, how do you want me to handle this? Father, may you give us opportunities this week to engage differently, and may we be diligent in spending time with you and in growing in who we are in Christ. As we pray and ask all of this in His precious name. Amen. So this week, there's a challenge. And the challenge is to make a point of engaging with someone that you know thinks differently to you. Not to try and convince them of your opinions, of your beliefs, but rather to learn. And then to see the doors of opportunity that will open that you never thought possible. And then to make a point of growing in your core identity by spending time in God's Word. And I want to encourage you, one of the most beautiful books that you could read that describes who you are in Christ is the book of Ephesians. In the Bible that I was reading, it was only 4 pages, 6 chapters, Ephesians chapter 1 through to 6. Read through and just absorb the truths that it shares. And then to establish your security in your core identity, just go and reread Romans chapter 8 and how that nothing will ever separate you from the love of God. And instead of us asking, what's the issue at a surface level, let's rather dig deeper and ask, Lord, how do you want me to handle this?